such an intensive workshop, between 2.5 and 3 hour workshop, and they're quite large, so that we only had 2 workshops, and there are 120 students. So each workshop had, you know, 50, 60 students enrolled in them. So it's a really large group, difficult to do whole group activities with students of that, a group of that size. So having to do small group work was really a necessity in terms of how we could teach the course. Wanted to get the students also trying to engage those theoretical ideas that were presented in the lecture into things that they actually can connect to their day-to-day lives. So each workshop was structured in 3 parts, where the first part would be around doing an exercise in class that was very general, that was talking about these broad concepts in sociology and trying to get them to talk about in their specific day-to-day lives. So one example, the first workshop we did was a sociological imagination exercise, where I said to them, okay, we've introduced the course, we've talked about what you need to do. Now, you know, I want you to go out and go to the coffee shop with your group. Go and sit in the coffee shop, have a chat, get to know each other. But also, I want you to write in your group journal a reflection on that, and as to why this is a sociological, what's sociological about what you're doing in that context. So the group journal was structured each week. There were kind of 2 parts to the journal. The first one was something where they had to kind of write in answers to a set question that was very obviously linked to the content, something to do with sociology. And it might have been a reflection, answer some questions that they had to draw from the reading that week, something, record their kind of activity in a table that week in terms of the responses. Each time we would usually have a short activity at the beginning, which was generating discussion based on personal experiences or based on something that they could personally log into on the web, say, for example, the ecological footprint exercise. But we also did ones where students get up and they move around the room. So we did mapping, so action research mapping. Each week I tried to do something very different. I tried to have some element of physicality in each week, so they're getting up, moving around, going outside, going and doing something and coming back. And that was because 2.5 hours sitting in a classroom is boring, and if students aren't coming anyway in summer, it had to be not boring. For each week, I would create, like, I guess, a PowerPoint in Blackboard, so all the activities are already there. Students can see them a week before. All the links to anything online we're doing, it's all there in their PowerPoint, so they're not turning up to class and I wasn't showing them something they've never seen. It's all accessible before they get to class, and they can do it in their own time as well. So we use the web. Each group has a computer that they sit around, and there was a mixture of activities. So they might need to go online. So, for example, in the environment week, they went online and did their ecological footprints, first as an individual through the online tool, then in their small groups, then they talked about that and compared what each other found, and then we talk about it as a group, and then there's a short question in the journal where they can write up their reflections on that activity. So it wasn't so much telling me this was my ecological footprint, but more about what that means for them, were there things that they might be able to do to reduce their ecological footprint. So hopefully trying to put some of those ideas from sociology with a tool that's out there in the world to kind of say, look, you know, lots of people are thinking about this in new ways, and how might you bring this back to your everyday life? I think that there were challenges around the internal group being those strategies that groups had to negotiate responsibilities and how much work people were expected to do and who should turn up and who shouldn't. And some students were quite concerned about that. And so early on, you know, we had questions around the equity issues in terms of how the group journal, the marks were being allocated. So very early on, it was quite clear that the group journal would be 1 result per group journal, and everyone in the group would receive the same mark for their journal, hoping this would be motivation for everybody to get involved. The peer evaluation, so they were kind of coupled, the peer evaluation was meant to be the component of the mark to address that fairness issue. So where students could then, say you've got 6 students in a group, they could each evaluate each other. Now if you've got 1 group member or 2 who weren't consistently not showing up or contributing, those students could show that in their peer evaluation and then I could relay that result. So that was a bit tricky to kind of manage those expectations within the groups. So we actually ended up doing somewhat of a combination. So if students receive 2.5 for their peer evaluation, this actually was then, their group journal was weighted slightly to reflect those peer evaluations.
And was that like a calculation, or yes. was that like, yeah?
Yeah, a calculation that I would then do. So, I mean, quite simple. Say the group journal, everyone gets 5% for their group journal, but then out of the group members, they've all peer evaluated each other. So I would then work out the average that each student would get, which that's totally fair for the peer evaluation. But then I actually could take that average and create a new kind of average out of group journal and peer evaluation of what's the average. Yep. So if a student got 5 for their group journal and 5 for their peer evaluation, then they get 5 for that group journal. But so it was a result that was calculated based on both. I would love to be able to have a room with big group tables with the computers in the middle. Now, some of them are like that. So we had one room that was like that, and the other one kind of had it was more all in a line. And yes, it was kind of flowing through, so you could have groups around the tables, but I still did find students were having a bit of trouble clustering around. What I would change is perhaps right up front in that first workshop is maybe spend more time on skills that students need for group work. I think that the workshops this year, they were much more interactive. The groups were much more cemented. So in previous years, we always did group work, but each week the students could choose if they wanted to have the same group members, if they wanted to always sit together, or if they just wanted to work with whoever they were near at the time. It was much less structured. And the initial feeling for the less structured was that I wanted students to feel that it was self-directed and that they could make those choices. However, what happened, I think, in reality then, is there was no continuity and students didn't necessarily have that buy-in into terms of, this is my group, we connect with each other. So this year, in having one group that stayed together throughout the whole term to do that work, I think the positive there is I could see students really building relationships, and there were really, as weeks went on, the discussions were more and more sociological and they were more and more kind of interactive. And interactions not just over kind of trivial interactions that we might have with a classmate that you don't see very often, you know, the hello, how are you kind of level, but actually interactions about hard questions about Indigenous poverty or histories of colonialism or whatever it might be, actually engaging on issues that are very connected to ethics. We need to know more and more how to interact with people with different perspectives from multidisciplinary backgrounds. So trying to facilitate, the group journal is really aimed at facilitating that cross-communication with people who might not speak the same disciplinary language and finding a common thread that students can learn from. And that was what the group journal was trying to do. It was less about the answer and more about the process. And I think that those communication skills are really, really important, and the critical thinking that comes from being able to listen and exchange views and perspectives is what makes students employable. Yes, they can have a disciplinary background, but it's all about, I think, those skills. So I hoped that that's what the group work would show. And I think the challenges that students experienced, while some students would have been quite frustrated with the process because they were relying on other students to be there or to have input, they're actually also very real challenges that we all will face when we go into the workplace and for employee relationships and employees in general. But I think using that journal to help students engage with the material in such a long class like that gave them a bit of a focus as well at the end of the class, and a way for them to wrap up what they've learned and put down their thoughts.
Yeah, great.